name is Andy Davis. I'm very happy to be asked to do this. I live down in Brattleboro, and I've been teaching music in the Vermont Public Schools for the last 30-some years. I also call Concord dances, square dances, sang for many years in a band called Noel Singing Clear, which did traditional archaic midwinter carols and customs with Tony Barron, John Roberts, and Fred Rudig. And so I'm sort of deeply rooted in traditions, but I've also been working right there in public education and introducing my students to the world of traditional music, as well as everything else we do in public education music programs. I wanted to start off by just finding out who you all are. So maybe we do a quick, I'm sort of interested to help me run the session, what kind of backgrounds you all are bringing, whether you're classroom teachers, music teachers, dance teachers, interested members of the public that just drove down the wrong road this morning. Decided to stay for the day. Would you be willing to just say?
Sure. I'm Carrie Trumbull. I'm a speech and language pathologist who works exclusively right now with preschool children, and I believe that both music and movement are great ways of fostering community and doing much needed sound practice all in one big fell swoop. So, yeah.
That's the workshop right there. That's great. Perfect. I love the early education thing because I'm going to talk about that. Yes?
I'm certified K-6, but I sometimes work with kids as early as 1.5 at a local art center with their parents in a family movement class.
Okay.
So I love dance. I take a lot of dance classes, and I sometimes teach like a movement class or a creative dance to little kids. I'm doing that at Chandler right now as an after school class.
Great.
And I've done a little bit of traditional social dance.
Great.
But not taught.
My name is Laura. I am a physical education teacher, K-2, and I do adult dance in my curriculum. I have, on the flip side, no musical background. Never played an instrument, can't sing, but I attempt to sing with my students. So I'd like to try to integrate some more singing, song with my traditional.
Modeling the attempt is very powerful. I once met a man down south, and he looked at me, he was very elderly, and said, "You know, I can't sing, but my family loves to hear me try."
My family does not.
I was going to say, that's a nice supportive family.
All right, great. Physical education, that's great.
Hi, I'm Susan, and I teach at UVM in the Early Childhood Program.
Which program?
Early Childhood. A licensure program from birth to third grade.
Great.
I'm here as a friend and colleague of Mark's, but also because, that's my secondary reason, but I had to throw it in. Just want to think about ways to incorporate parts of this in our coursework and service practices and get them thinking about this.
In terms of teaching teachers.
Yeah, teaching.
Great.
My name is Betsy Nolan, and I teach kindergarten through fifth grade music at Edmonds Elementary right here in Burlington. And I wrote the curriculum for the New Neighbors Project that I'll be presenting in March, so you'll see me then. And I love to dance. I do a lot of dance in my classroom, but I'm new to teaching elementary school. I've been away from it for 15 years working in middle school. So I'm looking to learn more dances and do...
we're going to get moving.
Find creative ways to work with limited space, which I appreciate that this space is big because this is...
I'm very lucky that I have...
We do lots of concentric circles in my classroom.
Yes.
Great, Larry.
My name is Larry Becker, and I'm kind of one of those people who drove down the road. But I knew about this, and then I walked in and I saw about this workshop. So I came to this one, and I know Andy from dancing with members of his singing group. Years ago, I learned from Tony Barron, Mars Dancing. But I have taught Mars Dancing at Kids Tent and at Foot Fest
So in the fall we go outside and dance, in the winter we do Irish step dancing in the hallway, and in the spring we go back outside. So I love new ideas for especially working with older kids who don't have a ton of dance background. Well, actually varying dance background. Some of them are quite accomplished ballet dancers and that type of thing, but limited traditional dance background.
I'm Jen Dewey, and I'm from Franklin, and I'm a preschool and a pre-K teacher. So I'm always looking for ways to bring music and into just across the board with math and science, and I'm not a great singer, but I sing anyway, and kids never mind, you know, they love it, so I'm kind of all about
my son is a beautiful singer, and his pre-K teacher, we would always say, she can't sing, but he learned more songs from her, he learned he really learned the American songbook from his pre-K teacher, who just sang for the joy of it.
And I make up songs, and we laugh, and it's just fun.
It's a powerful seed, just be that person.
So I'm happy you learned something like this, Benjamin, I live in Adamant, you're welcome near Montpelier. I have been a preschool music teacher, but now my main focus is calling a family dance in Plainfield.
Oh, fantastic.
That's great.
I'm the president of this organization. You asked me about
it. All right, Children's Music Network.
My name is John Place. I'm a special educator around the city. And I play a little banjo on the side. And just looking to recharge my musical batteries and my confidence level to get as much of it as possible into the class today.
Yeah. And tell us, would you share a little bit about your students, your assignment?
Sure, yeah. I work in an intensive special ed program. It's, working with children who need a lot of therapeutic supports as part of their school day. And so I'm lucky that they challenge me in ways to find some answers to some difficult questions or help them find answers. So certainly music is one of them.
That's a subject dear to my heart. I have a daughter who's now 21 with Down syndrome, and she grew up totally encased in traditional music and dance. And so this whole subject of inclusion is really important to me. Wow. This is about, we have about a little over an hour to do what's normally a 6-week
We can do it.
We can do it. So a couple of comments. I love this thing where the future intersects the past. Made me think of something someone once told me, you have to treat every moment as a gift. That's why they call it the present. All right. It'll hit you later. I was sitting there listening to Laura, and everything she said I found really affirming. Laura said was really fantastic. I came into school just this week on Tuesday, and a little kid said to me, they saw me out of the corner of their eye and said, "Oh, we get you today." And I thought, well, that's music education. It has nothing to do with curriculum. It's an experience, okay?
Yeah.
It's an experience that's positive in their life. And that's really, you know, what I think that really brought me to the core of it, that little kid. We get you today. And all this highfalutin stuff, I wrote a piece years ago called Culture, Not Curriculum. Because we get together as music educators and we make all these graphs and charts and everything of the curriculum, then we put them in a folder on the shelf and we go back to being musicians and community builders. And that's really what this is all about. I thought it was a little interesting that we have a song workshop going over there and a dance workshop over here. And I believe firmly the two are really one. And in many cultures, there's not even a separate word for song and dance. So part of what's going to happen here is we're going to see that singing is really a movement with even beginning with the youngest kids with finger plays is part of a continuum that leads to square dancing, contra dancing, ritual dance, maypole dance, all of it, but it's a one piece of cloth. So when your little kids are sitting there and you're, you know, playing, telling stories with your fingers, it's physical response to music. And without physical response to music, music isn't really happening, okay? It's not a purely intellectual process, as we know. So, you know, the first Vermont standard, and I thought of this too when she was talking, are any of you familiar with the Vermont music standards? It's kind of nice, I memorized it, to sing alone and together a varied repertoire of music in a cooperative manner. Okay, it's to be included in something with other people. Okay, and a varied to sort of, all right. So that's just a couple of ideas. I like the play-space thing. I don't do a lot of, I do some really roots music from Vermont. But I do a lot of stuff that works, okay? And that's, again, I like that idea that Laura had about context. Okay, now we have a lot of early childhood people. So what I'm gonna do is to try to run through just touch some of my, a lot of repertoire here. Don't feel like you have to write everything down. There's a handout here that has a lot of the lyrics, directions. I didn't bring many of them. If you, I'll put out a sheet for email and I'll send you a PDF. I brought that for people that don't yet have computers. Anybody here not yet got a computer? Everybody has a computer? So anyway, take a hard copy if you're, you know, living in the, off the grid someplace, okay. So I need some people who will just curl up in little tiny balls on the floor.
Okay.
I know. See, I knew you would do it. I knew you would do it. Now, other people, I have to warn you, this is not going to be very interesting to watch. I did this in Cuba recently. I went with a delegation of music educators to Cuba. And I, in my halting Spanish, I explained the story to the kids. I left that out. Song, dance, and story are one. Okay?
Wow.
So whenever you introduce music, it's also about telling a story. So you are sleeping bunnies, okay? How many of you know this? It's a very elemental piece of music. We'll just see how smart you are and see if you get it. See the little bunny sleeping till it's nearly noon. See if we can wake them with a merry. that piece of repertoire, but that idea of completely contrasting on-off directions embedded in the music and the story is really teaching dance. It's teaching response to different musical energies, styles. It's a story, okay? All right, so I need some people who can gallop, and we're going to gallop around in this direction here in the corral. So, you know, galloping is one way to run. Developmentally, it's a lot easier than skipping. This is one I think I got from the Langstaff, one of the Langstaff collections. Here we go riding our ponies, our ponies, our ponies. Here we go riding our ponies. Whoa! 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 Now turn and face somebody, even if they're sitting down. Stop a minute and you say, how are you this very fine day? And off, and you can shake. I teach sort of the sociability. How are you this very fine day? And off we go. Here we go riding our ponies, our ponies, our ponies. Here we go riding our ponies. Whoa! Because when he was playing this music in, you know, the Bronx growing up, it wasn't Latin jazz. They were just playing the music that was all around them. It was, and it reminds me of something that Yo-Yo Ma said to an interviewer. He said, I hate the term classical music. And the interviewer said, well, what do you propose to call it? And he said, music. Okay, so, you know, I like Laura was also playing with that whole thing about labels and how they can really get in our way. So, everybody stand up. This is a summer camp piece. There are many versions of this. If you go, how many of you use YouTube as a source of traditions, musical traditions? You can find anything from maypole dancing, any name of any song, and you'll find many versions of it. How about spread around instead of being in a circle? Just face me in a mob. There we go. Anyone know a version of Form the Corn? Kids really love this. I do it with the whole school. K to 6, pre-K to 6. All right, it's kind of got a hip-hop feel to it. As much of a hip-hop feel as I'm You've got to form the corn. Form, form the corn. You've got to form the corn. Form, form the corn. You've got to shuck the corn. Shuck, shuck the corn. You've got to shuck the corn. Shuck, shuck the corn. You've got to pop the corn. Pop, pop the corn. You've got to pop the corn. Pop, pop the corn. Got to form potato. Form, form potato. Got to form potato. Form, form potato. Got to peel potato. Peel, peel potato. Got to peel potato. Peel, peel potato. Got to mash potato. Mash, mash potato. Got to mash potato. Mash, mash potato. Got to form the squash. Form, form the squash. You've got to form the squash. Form, form the squash, you've got to slice the squash, slice, slice the squash, you've got to slice the squash, slice, slice the squash, you've got to squish the squash, squish, squish the squash, you've got to squish the squash, squish, squish the squash, you've got to form banana, form, form banana, got to form banana, form, form banana, got to peel banana, peel, peel banana, got to called Form the Corn. There's tons of versions of that, and you can also create, kids can make up their own verses, and kind of a little compositional project, because, you know, you want each verse to have some kind of, what do you do with that thing? And try to find some alliteration and things like that. There's tons. A lot of that stuff I do with early kids is in a book we published called I'm Growing Up. I don't know why I didn't bring that book, but if you're interested, you can contact me, andy@dancingmasters.com. So anyway, let's do one more in the early years here, a real favorite, and then we're going to start sort of moving through. The thing about many of these old games is they're not age graded. They're not graded by age. So we get calls at New England Dancing Master, what grade is that dance for? And I say, well, that dance is good for anyone from about 6 to 106. That's a traditional dance. It can be done in the community dance. I once ran into recently a middle school teacher. My kids love Alabama Gal. Well, I do Alabama Gal with little kids because it's a very proto dance. But if you're presenting Alabama Gal to a group of middle schoolers, like you believe in it, and it's a great dance, which it is, it's sort of a Virginia Reel type of dance, they're going to love it, okay? It's all about context and presentation. It's not about there's these graded set of activities, okay? All right. How about...
Which is kind of the multi-generational part of participatory.
Yeah, and our schools aren't really set up for that. It takes a little bit of... we do dance... We have a thing every week in my... I'm in two K-6 schools, and I do K-2 in another school with another teacher doing the other kids. We do all school sing once a week. That includes singing, dancing, skits by the kids, a few announcements we try to minimize. But we do all school dancing, and the older kids love dancing with the little kids. It's like a real treat for them to interact across the generations. What did you say, Sonia?
How is the duration of your all school?
30 minutes. 30 minutes. So let's do, someone mentioned the Vermont folk life person was talking about kind of our roots here in Vermont. How many of you do a version of Old Roger? You know, a lot of old games are about two things, love and death. And there are two things we tend to avoid. It's interesting, but children's culture in the past was fascinated by, they were fascinated by what all of us are dealing with, love and death. So I have just barreled ahead with those things. One time Peter Evergon said to me in November, boy, I just looked at my lesson book and all I've done is songs about dead animals. Okay, Shaw Blue, Go Tell Aunt Rhody. You know, all of these classic old American songs are about loss. Loss of an animal, loss of, okay, courtship, love, Thorn Rosa, you know, you all do versions of Thorn Rosa. It's a German singing game that tells the story of Sleeping Beauty. Someone gave me a rewrite of it to make it modern. It didn't have all of the stuff from Grimm's, and I didn't tell them this. I was too polite. But I would never do that with kids. They completely ruined it by making it, you know, politically correct. All right. So, Old Roger, everybody stand up. When I worked with this, I start off teaching it just with the whole school, the whole class singing it. This is a colonial game that's found in England. I met a guy recently from West Virginia who does a version of Old Roger, but it's a different name, Old Abram or something like that. Old Roger is dead and he lies in his grave, lies in his grave, lies in his grave. Old Roger is dead and he lies in his grave. So don't you notice, I mean, how many of you have heard that tune before? But that's the power of traditional music. There's a form there, it's the exact same form as Soldier's Joy that Laura was playing. Okay, a question and an answer, or a repeated line. What I think Pete Sullivan calls recycled material, okay? And it's the power of it. You participate immediately. I often tell people with these songs, these aren't songs you learn. These are songs you just do, okay? Old Roger is dead and he lies in his grave, lies in his grave, lies in his grave. Old Roger is dead and he lies in his grave. We heart lies in his grave. They planted an apple tree over his head, over his head, over his head. They planted an apple tree over his head, wee high over his head. The apples got ripe and they fell to the ground, fell to the ground, fell to the ground. The apples got ripe and they fell to the ground, wee high, fell to the ground. There came an old woman a picking them up, picking them up, picking them up. There came an old woman a picking them up, wee high, picking them up. Old Roger got up and he gave her a scare, gave her a scare, gave her a scare. Old Roger got up and he gave her a scare, wee high, gave her a scare. Which made the old woman go hippity hop, hippity hop, hippity hop. Which made the old woman go hippity hop, wee high, hippity hop. All right, so you start off teaching it like that. And then you get volunteers for the old Roger and the tree and the old woman. And it's sort of like a chase game, okay? And then I realized that you could have many old Rogers on the floor,
yeah,
and many trees ready to grow, and many old women off in the corners ready to come out and steal the apples. So the whole room is just filled with people, you know, telling that story, okay? So, old Roger. All right, now, let's do improvisation. Laura was talking about improvisation. Do any of you do any version of Down in the Valley? We're going down in the valley. This is a great community dance, too, but I love it in the classroom. Everybody, put your voice down. Stand up and go face somebody, anybody. Just face anybody. This is from the collection of Bessie Jones called Step It Down. You all know that famous, famous book. Bessie Jones was declared a national treasure by the National Endowment for the Humanities or something like that. She had grew up in the Georgia Sea Islands, African-American woman, and her grandparents had been in slavery. And she was just one of these magical people that remembered everything growing up. And then she ended up traveling around the country with the Georgia Sea Island Singers, Little Sally Walker. There's a great, the book is just love. Zodiac, how many of you do a version of Here We Go Zodiac? I think she calls it Zudio or Sodio. But all of these, and that book is loaded with all the contextual stories, what these games actually mean. Toni Morrison even wrote a novel called Song of Solomon, which is all based on a children's singing game, about how it encased a whole family's history. So, again, there are stories behind all of these things. So, face your partner. This is kind of the New England Dancing Master's choreography for this. This is not a traditional choreography, but again, it works. If it works, it's good. I think Duke Ellington said, if it sounds good, it is good. All right. So, give one hand to your partner. Now, do any of you ever wonder, how do you get your kids to join hands? Is that a problem? For one thing, get rid of the word hold.
Yes.
We join hands. We do not hold hands. I've heard teachers say, now I want you to hold hands. Take hands would be good, too. I actually, you can let go of hands. I actually, as the kids get into around third and fourth grade, we actually talk about, well, what is a partner? And when the dance is over, you thank your partner, and they're not your partner anymore. Oh,
yeah, I'm so glad you said that. You can see the little kids going, this is great.
I'm with that guy, but I won't be with him the rest of the day.
Yeah.
Just till the end of this dance. I mean, if you don't tell kids, they don't know. Okay? I mean, really, I'm serious, okay? And I know we have a PE teacher here, and I feel like one of the things that really has to be, we can't teach this as movement. It's social dance, and they need to understand that it's a social component. And I've seen some PE teachers who treat it as movement, and it's a social activity with teaching the kids how to ask someone to be their partner, how to say thank you at the end of the dance. So I never do a partner type of dance without thank you for the dance. Mm-hmm. You're welcome. So anyway, take right hand, and then take left hands at the same time. And what we're going to do is start moving your hands. hands back and forth, and you'll notice that that gets your shoulders going, okay, and then that gets your spine sort of twisting, and your hips going, you know, the hip bone connects to the knee bone, and then your heels start sliding on the floor, all of that, you mention all, everything needs to be okay. But if it turns turns into a bunch of kids rolling around on the floor, you know, being inappropriate. So that's just a judgment you make as an educator. But to me, I wouldn't try to tell them how to do that.
So you don't practice it with any, like,
no,
yeah.
We do not, I've
rhythmic,
never done anything on that.
You said the rhythmic part, too. You said, like, you make a rhythmic, a motion that goes with the rhythm.
Well, that's my general term. Make a motion that is connects to this music.
Okay.
The rhythm or the beat or the tempo of the music. But you're totally free.
I find that kids generally will accommodate for their partner too.
Yeah.
I mean, generally, if a student does something and they very quickly realize the partner can't do it, or the partner will flat out be like, that's too hard, I can't do that.
Mm.
And I don't, I
yeah.
just leave it open-ended. They'll figure it out. And that
yeah.
comes to the social piece.
That's
and
true.
Being respectful
yeah.
of other people's
yeah.
differences.
And the consequence of intervening as the teacher is saying, no, that's not the right thing.
Yeah.
It's going to make a resistant kid or a kid who doesn't have a lot of experience do movement
yeah.
not willing to take the risk the next time. So,
yeah. I like the improvisational aspect. I also like, and it happened both times you chose partner, I saw two people go, what, they're really good? You know, I love that moment in the classroom when two completely unexpected children who don't interact much with each other, they just go, oh, we're partners, you know? And it's like this moment of letting go and stepping outside of their comfort zone because the dance is so compelling, okay?
Mm-hmm.
I'm not gonna just stand here, you know, and see that person. I have seen that too.
Sometimes they do that, right?
Yeah, they'll see a kid and I'm going, no way I'm going over there. I'll just stand here by myself. But generally, the power of that, I love the rhythm. I don't know if you've noticed, there's a missing beat in there, which lends to the excitement of it. Instead of rise, Sally, rise, two, three, okay? It's rise, Sally, rise. Well, let me see you make a, it's very Cajun, sort of. But the fact that we're not doing 8-beat patterns, there's some missing beats in there, which makes the excitement. That's on one of our recordings over here.
Is that called Rise, Sally, Rise?
It's called Down in the Valley. But the book title, Rise, Sally, Rise, comes from that. Okay, everybody, put your books down, make one circle. This is another African-American one. And then we're going to get into some sort of more Anglo, contra, circle dancing kinds of things. And I want to do something, talk a little bit about the recorded music in the classroom. Because, I mean, I play a lot of instruments, so I am often using live instruments. But if there's 15 kids in the class that day, and I know I'm going to be doing something that needs partners, I go, well, I'm dancing today, and I'm thinking of what CD I'm going to put on. So they get a mix of live music, and they get a mix of recorded music. I used to be sort of doctrinaire, thinking, they hear too much recorded music. But there's nothing better than dancing with your students. It's a great way to interact with them and model for them. They'll learn more than you could ever explain, just if you're a contra or a square dancer, watching how you move to the music. They'll learn more than anything you could explain. So just make a circle, no partners, okay? And I'm going to step in the middle. This is one of my favorites. It's called Dinah's Dead. And it's not really about death. It's about gossip. And it's about a community sharing news, okay? This came from, I think, a book called Slice the Ice. This game, you can let go of hands. There's no hands in this. I was just trying to get you into a circle. Oh, circles. I came up with a thing that I've been finding that works really well. I have kids make a just right circle. How many of you have ever had that experience of saying, oh, everyone take a step backwards, and then kids are like falling over furniture in the back corner of the room, okay? Kids love to exaggerate. They're wired to do that. There's a limit. Let me see if I can find it, okay? It's not they're misbehaving. That's actually how their brain is wired. So from the story of Goldilocks, I came up with the idea of a just right circle. Some circles are too big. And they're not round, and you're tripping over things. And some circles are so small that you're crowded and you're uncomfortable. And there is this other circle called a just right circle. First graders can make a just right circle. Instead of you being in charge and saying, you're not doing it right, you need to do what I tell you to do, just tell them really in their terms what you need to do the dance. And they will make a just right circle. I also use lightly and politely. I do a lot of writing in my direction, so when they join hands. This question often comes up, how do you get your kids to join hands? The best thing is start kids have it done, just all join hands. Oh, I mean, they're broken, sorry. They're so relieved when they hear that. Oh, I saw that. They didn't need to join hands. White people, I don't know. Oh, let's not. Let's not. So they're laughing, and that's a game. Okay. Oh, I can't make up my mind. And then we begin the dance. Okay. And it's just something. So Dinah's dead. If you heard that Dinah, who lived in the community, had died, what would be the first question that would come into your mind? Exactly. So that's where this game comes from. It's call and response, which is a higher level than echo. Echo is really important too. I do tons of echoing with little kids, echo songs. But here we move into call and response. Dinah's dead, and you say, well, how did she die? Okay? Dinah's dead.
Well, how did she die?
She died like this.
Well.
And you go, she died like this. Okay? Dinah's dead.
Well, how did she die?
She died like this.
She died like this.
But her sister's still living. Okay, so it's not like the community is completely done for when Dinah died. I mean, this happens in the community. So your answer is, well, where is she living? Okay, all right. But her sister's still living.
Well, where is she living?
She's living in a place called, and you guys join right in. She's
living in a place called Tennessee.
With a short, short dress all above her knee. This is gossip. It's all about kids are mimicking what they hear parents saying over the back fence, okay? With that short, short dress. Who raised that child? Okay. So here's the whole game. Here we go. Dinah's dead.
Well, how did she die?
She died like this.
She died like this.
Dinah's dead.
Well, how did she die?
She died like this.
She died like this.
But her sister's still living.
Well, where is she living?
She's living in a place called Tennessee. With a short, short dress all above her knee. Hands up, Dizzy Lizzie, Tennessee. Hands down, Dizzy Lizzie, Tennessee. Turn around, Dizzy Lizzie, Tennessee. Touch the ground, Dizzy Lizzie, Tennessee. Well, she never went to college and she never went to school. And when she came back, she was an educated fool. You go in the middle and say, Dinah's dead.
Dinah's dead.
See, well, you guys will just do it. But sometimes a kid will say, I don't know what to do. And I say, go in the middle and say, Dinah's dead.
Yeah.
And then they do it. They do the whole thing, okay?
Dinah's dead.
Well, how did she die?
She died like this.
She died like this.
Dinah's dead.
Well, how did she die?
She died like this.
She died like this.
But her sister's still living.
Well, where is she living? She's living in a place called Tennessee. With short, short skirts all above her knee.
Hands up, Tizzy Lizzy, Tennessee.
Hands down, Tizzy Lizzy, Tennessee.
Turn around, Tizzy Lizzy, Tennessee.
Touch the ground, Tizzy Lizzy, Tennessee.
Well, she never went to college, she never went to school. And when she came back, she was an educated fool.
Dinah is dead.
Well, how did she die?
She died like this.
She died like this.
Well, Dinah is dead.
Well, how did she die?
She died like this.
She died like this.
But her sister is living.
Well, where is she living? She's living in a place called Tennessee. With short, short skirts all above her knee. Hands up, Tizzy Lizzy, Tennessee. Hands down, Tizzy Lizzy, Tennessee.
Turn around, Tizzy Lizzy,
Tennessee. Touch the ground, Tizzy Lizzy, Tennessee.
Well, she never went to college.
She never went to school.
Stopping this game. You always want to do one more with the kid, you know. And I love in a game like this that once they get going, maybe the second week or third week we've done it for a little bit, I just wander out of the circle and just occasionally like call out a word if someone forgets a word, but just let go or start tapping on a hand drum or something and just let it, because these are street games.
Yes.
In that culture, okay? Sorry, next time. Have a seat.
And what about that? What I hope is that what we
slightly different in each village's tradition, okay? Because people didn't get over to that village 5 miles away, but maybe a couple times in a lifetime, you know? They had their own traditions close as neighbors. So let's move into some dance stuff here. Do you all know about the term play party game? This is a piece of American history. I love this story, telling this to the kids. When the pioneers were moving west, there was also, as you know, in American history, a lot of new communities that were moving west and forming were very religious in nature. And it was often a prohibition on instrumental music. How many of you have ever heard any of those folk tales about the possession of the fiddler? Well, if you've ever been at a rip snorting dance with one fiddler in the middle of the room, making the whole room dance like they've never danced in their lives, you can see why a local pastor or religious leader might have gotten a little jealous of that power and started saying, well, that must be from some other realm that we don't approve of. But I say to the kids, this is not a first grade conversation. This is more like fifth, sixth grade. But because they get a sense of history and they've studied something about it. So anyway, these were pioneer people. They were smart. They knew how to have a square dance without a fiddler. Okay. So this thing got created. You can go online and type in play party games. And you'll get some scholarly papers. You'll get some YouTubes of different things. I'll do one called Old Bald Eagle. These were essentially square dances without the fiddler. And you notice play party game does not have the word dance in it?
Yeah.
Come on over, we're going to do some play parties. They were square dances done with the singing. And this is really old in American, in world culture, a carol. We talk about Christmas carols. A carol was a dance originally. They were not just at Christmas. They were spring carols, autumn carols, midsummer carols. They were dances where the music was provided by the singing of the dancers. And this is great for building a school dance culture. We do a lot of them. You could sort of say that Dinah's Dead is a kind of African-American hip-hop carol, okay? Because it's the music is provided by the participants. So everybody put your notes down. This is called Old Bald Eagle, and it's an American play party game. And you need a partner for this. So who knows how to ask somebody to be a partner? I do this with my students. Who's got some words you could use?
Would you like to be
my partner? Who's got some different words? Different words.
Do you want to dance?
You want to dance. I love that one.
Want to dance?
I sometimes tell the kids, my favorite one is this one. All right, so does everyone have a partner? All right, so make a circle. I think we have an even number of participants here. Okay. So all join hands, lightly and politely. So it starts off with a forward and back. Forward and back, cross the floor, daylight is gone again. Forward and back, cross the floor, daylight is gone. You swing yours and I'll swing mine. So a swing now. Swing. Oh, this is a whole week long discussion, but we could just use an elbow swing, okay? Either a square or a contra dancer, you might want to do your ball, your love step swing. But the thing that makes it a swing, and I tell this to the kids, is the attention you're paying your partner. Can I get a volunteer here? This is not a swing, okay? That's not a swing, okay? This could be a swing. This is a swing because I'm giving my partner my attention and I'm confirming they're having as much fun as I think they might be having, okay? By looking at them, okay? So that's all that makes it a swing. It can be a two-hand turn, it could be an elbow swing, it could be a bust step swing, it could be a cross-hand swing. So you swing yours and I'll swing mine. Daylight is gone. You swing yours and I'll swing mine. Daylight is gone. Both as a big circle, but it can also be done as a square. One couple at a time sails around, which is the promenade. So let me teach everybody the promenade. The way I teach it to kids, there's lots of promenades. more like your hand behind you there. This is a very common one in comp threat and square dancing. But again, it's a little too cozy, I find, for elementary school kids, okay? So right to right, just a handshake hold, left to left. And the way it works, let's have everybody promise first. Old bald eagle, stay around, daylight is gone. Old bald eagle, stay around, daylight is gone. Forward and back across the floor, daylight is gone. Forward and back across the floor, daylight is gone. You swing yours and I'll swing mine, daylight is gone. You swing yours and I'll swing mine, daylight is gone. Let's just start with one couple. Let's have you two start, okay?
Okay.
Old bald eagle, stay around.
Daylight is gone. Old bald eagle, stay around. Daylight is gone. Forward and back across the floor. Daylight is gone.
Woo!
Forward and back across the floor. Daylight is gone.
You
I'll swing yours and I'll swing mine. Daylight is gone.
You
swing yours and I'll swing mine.
They were sort of done in communities so repetitively that everybody knew them. You didn't, but in patter call or contra calling, you're always timing your calls at the last several beats of the previous phrase, okay? So now we're gonna get into like some social dancing. We've got about 15, 20 minutes here. So how many of you know Lucky Seven? I'm gonna use this as an example to share the use of recorded music. So find a mix around, find a new partner. Alright. Now this is my version. There's many versions of this. It's a classic mixer. Are you familiar with the term mixer? Now, a couple of years ago, I met a caller who does a lot of community-type dances like I do. I do a lot of community dances for schools and summer camps and weddings and parties and that kind of thing. And they said, they use the term, I was calling them no-mix mixers, but they were calling them keepers, where you teach the mix, the dance, but you leave out the changing partners thing. And if you're calling, you look out and you see some three-year-olds or some seven-year-olds, little tiny kids there, and you're not going to say, but later in the evening, if that kid and family have stuck around for over an hour, I have the parents tell the kids, this next dance, you're going to be dancing with other people, and then we'll get back together at the end. And I say, you tell your child that. Don't let them wander off because the strange guy on the stage is telling them to wander off. Okay? But early in the evening, so almost any dance in our collections that say mixer can be adapted as keepers. It's a really great way to teach all those basic figures. And if the kids don't know they were supposed to mix, they think nothing's missing.
Right.
Again, scaffolding. Then after a couple weeks, you say, hey, there's a really cool thing you can do with this dance. And then they're really excited. Oh, my goodness, they get to dance with other people. Gender, we could have a whole 3-week discussion on gender in traditional dance, in school. schools and in communities. I just went contra dancing at Oberlin College, man, whew. Anybody dances any part, okay? They've really turned gents and ladies into two roles, and anyone can dance any role. And it's pretty much like what I've been doing in the public elementary school music education for years. We don't actually talk much about gents and ladies until we get into squares. And then I sort of want to let them know there's a tradition behind this of a gentleman, a lady, but boy, gender is it can be a minefield in a school. And so you have to really be sensitive to what's going on, and make the main goal is to make people comfortable. And that's why I think it's worth talking about what a partner is, what your responsibilities are, what your responsibilities aren't. So Lucky Seven, here we go. I'm going to play you sort of a more contemporary piece of music. I do this with like four upper elementary kids, this particular dance, and they really like it. So, no, I wish I did. It's a new instrument I'm working on. I think it's pretty cool because it's a classic iPod. It's not one of the newer ones, but it's true folky. I'm going to be using this for like the rest of my life. It's got more than enough that I have. Now, all join hands, go forward and back. One, two, three, woo! Come back, do it again. One, two, three, woo! That woo is very therapeutic. I tell them that it's very therapeutic. If they scream, I say, no, not therapeutic. It has to be short, right on beat. Woo! And if they go, woo! Not too long. Because it's only satisfying if it's that burst. It's not how loud it is, it's when it is, and what it is, okay? Next thing you do, face your partner. You all chose partners, correct? Yes, you could dance this with me. Are you around for the next few minutes?
Yes.
But let me finish setting this up and teach you. Do-si-do, who knows what a do-si-do is? I'm it comes from the French, is it supposed to? There was a big online discussion about this, and a lot of theories that involve Popeye The only convincing answer that I found in that discussion was that some PE teacher invented this so that they would know where the fifth grade boy's hands were. Around here, we don't dance the do-si-do like that. We just dance it like this, okay? And nowadays, you're conquered. This is not technically a do-si-do. I think it's called a crazy whirligig. Because do-si-do comes from le français. Do-a-do, do-a-do, back to back. Okay? So it's really only a do-si-do if you pass back to back. Okay? So that's
this is definitely like 4 years ago, learned that.
It is.
Clearly.
Exactly.
It's really old too.
And that's not, that gets back to my definition of tradition. How people do it around here. And when you're teaching in a small Vermont town or there might be a contra dance in the neighborhood, you want to teach it the way it's sort of done in that locale, not the way it's in a Henry Ford's 1927 book of squares. Okay. All right. So I'm trying to find this. Now, brace your partner. And we're going to do something called the grand right and left, which I tell kids is one of the major achievements of Western civilization. Okay. You give right hands to your partner, and your partner is one, okay? And you're going to pass, don't go yet, because it only works if we all start together. You're going to pass, you get two steps to pass each person, and you alternate hands as you go. So you're weaving. In Quebec, they call it le grand chain. A great chain, okay? You're going to count, though. So as you pass your partner, you say one. As you pass the second person, you count two. When you see seven coming, you're going to do a right elbow turn with them, okay? Okay? Do a right elbow swing with them, okay? So here we go. Grand right and left. Pass one,
two, three, four, five, six.
Make sure who knows who's an inside person and who's an outside person on the promenade. Let them promenade this person. Promenade. tap circle left and circle right. I like doing it with the forward and back. And then it happens again. I think you've got it. You've got a new partner there. And let's see if I can.
What do you do when they turn around and back the other way?
Oh, if you do this in Nutshell, don't do what all dancers do. There's only one way to promenade.
No, the grand right left.
The grand right, oh, if they go in the wrong direction?
Yeah, if they just
go.
Oh,
here's my, yeah, this is a school choreography. Do-si-do your partner, your current partner. And now face them and clear your mind. I added 8 beats of clearing your mind. Okay. Give right hand and do not dare to leave till you hear the magic words, grand right and left, and then you go, okay? Because as soon as someone takes off early, they leave a trail of confusion. Some of them like that role. That's kind of their role, okay?
I would say no grand.
Sorry, this is what I hate about technology. I've come to in my schools when any someone mentions technology, I say, oh, good, break. Okay. Because, I know, it's listed under somebody else. Sorry, I just wanted to share with you, I should have had this queued up. I didn't know I was going to do this. talks about being a farmer and singing what he's, the song that pops in his head when he's, you know, working with his horses and stuff, and he sings, and kids are just spellbound. It's that context. They're getting more than a music curriculum. They're getting the connection between music and life, okay? And that's that ball of song and story and dance. All, and he also plays the fiddle. Pretty scratchy, but then he'll get out his fiddle and I'll have the kids do a really simple little dance and talk about, you know, this was a really important part of farm life in Vermont. There was a thing in the history of Dover where it said the only time young people ever got together was when there was a square dance. So in the summer, there were three or four a week at different farms, okay, because that was the way you got together. So people being enterprising said, well, this is the only way we're going to get together. Let's get together all the time, okay? And you know, they'd be in the summer, they put the chair up on the wood stove in the kitchen so the fiddler wouldn't waste valuable dance space. Okay. And there's a lot of great stories of kitchen junkets. And so that whole thing, that man from, I don't remember his name, Vermont Folk Life Center, if you can connect it to the fourth grades in Vermont, do a lot of Vermont history. And it's really good to teach like a golden slipper square or something and say, you know, these are the traditional dances of Vermont that have bound communities together. And you don't hear about them much. They're not on TV. They're not on the radio. But they're deep, deep in our culture. And to be an educated person, you should have some experience. I tell them, you got to know how to do a grand right and left. Because if you're walking down the road with seven of your friends and a car goes by and someone goes, grand right and left, out the window, you better know what to do. All right, and they love the grand right and left. They love it because if you see a kid who's a little uncomfortable and you're talking about joining hands and they do this routine, how many of you ever seen this in the classroom? I always say, you know, I've never seen when I was growing up, my mom or dad never shook hands with somebody like this. And, you know, they never did that. And, you know, it's just a show of respect, joining hands with people. So we could do another dance or we could sort of, I always feel like you all have huge amounts of experience. Does anyone have any comments? That doesn't have to be questions, because I'm not the expert, even though I'm from out of town. It's an old definition of an expert, yeah. Someone from out of town.
So I've had my kids take almost anything that we do and they want to own it. So, you know, they'll want to be telling their own stories, they'll want to be, you know, demonstrating their own moves. So they're really big into improvisation.
Yeah.
They've got a lot of ideas in the week after. So, you know, as I look at things and thinking about, you know, which ones lend themselves the most to that, are there any that pop to your...
Well, what age kids are you working with?
6 through 8.
Yeah. Well, I love the a lot of the African American stuff that we published in Down the Valley here, and there's a ton of other collections. Wigaloo, you guys know Wigaloo? I learned that from a group of teenagers. It's also, I've seen it on YouTube as part of a cheer or football game. But it's for the, you're right, that age group is really dealing with issues around identity and self and what makes me. Everybody put the book down. This is traditional. It's not traditional in the sense of banjos and fiddles, but just stand up. You gotta remember how to. We do this at all schools sing. I'll say, "Hey, Oak Grove School!" I just stand up in the front of on the stage and just say, and all the kids go, "Hey, what?" Okay. So that's your response. "Hey, Oak Grove School!"
"Hey, what?"
Are you ready? And you say, "For what?" Okay. So are you ready?
For what?
"Hey, Oak Grove School!"
"Hey, what?"
Are you ready?
"For what?"
"To wig." And then you say, "Wig what?" Okay. Right? "To wiggle, to wig."
"Wig what?"
"To wiggle-o." And you all say, "Uh-oh."
"Uh-oh."
"My hands are high, my feet are low, and this way I wiggle-o." And you then copy me.
"My hands are high, my hands are low, and this is how I wiggle-o."
Yeah, so you know some versions. But I saw it done with a group of teens where each person, the way they did wiggle-o was something that they loved to do. That was part of who they were. Like, "This is the way I wiggle-o." And then everybody went, "This is the way I wiggle-o." You get what I'm saying? So they were telling their story about what their interests were, okay, and improvising emotion, okay? I would we've never published that, but that's just learned that through the folk process. At Pinewoods, I learned that from Bill Wellington. He learned it at a Boys and Girls Club in Annapolis, Maryland, from a group of teenagers, and he shared it one family week at Pinewood. So let's do the whole thing. Hey, Burlington!
Hey, what?
Are you ready?
For what?
To wig.
Wig what?
To wiggle-o.
Oh.
Who's got one? Oh, I forgot to tell you the best part. So then I would say, hey, Pat.
Hey, what?
Hey, what?
Are you ready?
For what?
To wig.
Wig what?
To wiggle-o. You're the leader.
Hey.
My hands are high. And then when we're done, we're the last leader, you say, hey.
Hey, Laurel.
Hey, what?
Are you ready?
Ready for what?
To wig.
Wig.
What?
To
wiggle.
To wiggle.
She's the soloist now. My
this
hands are
high.
And she does it all by herself. You don't move at all. Let her be a soloist. And then we do it.
My hands are high, my feet are low, and this is how I wiggle low.
All right. And then when we're done, you say hey to the next person.
Hey, Nicole.
Hey, what?
Hey, what?
Are you
ready?
For
what?
To wig.
Wig. What?
To wiggle low. Walking is an improvisational activity. And in traditional dance, that's one of the things that makes it so accessible. And teaching international folk dances, you do some of that, don't you?
Yeah, sure.
I've done some Greek and some Bosnian dances and stuff like that. But boy, the kids are really challenged by the right-left thing and the shifting of weight. And in square and contra dance,